Grace, mercy, and peace be yours in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for today is taken from our epistle lesson. I read again 2 Corinthians 3:14. But their minds were hardened, for to this day, when they read the old covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Here ends the reading of our text. May God add his blessings to the reading of his word. Amen. In our epistle lesson, Paul is talking about an Old Testament story with all that business about a veil being lifted and unlifted. And that story comes from Exodus, and perhaps you don't remember it right away. So I'm going to go ahead and read it. It's from Exodus chapter 34. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hand as he came down from the mountain, Moses did not know that the skin on his face shone because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, and behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses talked with them. Afterward, all the people of Israel came near, and he commanded them all that the Lord had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. Whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would remove the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the people of Israel what he was commanded, the people of Israel would see the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face was shining. And Moses would put the veil over his face again until he went in to speak with him. That's the story that Paul is referring to. And when we consider Paul's use of that story, we see another great example of how the Holy Spirit-inspired writers of the New Testament found Jesus in the Old Testament. Few today would be as bold as Paul in discovering this New Testament connection. So we thank the Holy Spirit that Paul did. The glory that shone from the face of Moses that so frightened the Israelites was a reflected glory of God. What we might not have appreciated if Paul had not made this connection is that for him, for Paul, it is the same glory that was shining on the day that Jesus was transfigured. But Jesus, unlike Moses, shone with unborrowed light. To see Jesus is to see the same glory that Moses saw. At his transfiguration, Jesus' divinity was displayed, the same glory of divinity that Moses saw. Peter, James, and John then had the same response that the Old Testament Israelites had. Mark says that they were terrified. Moses covered his face with a veil, hiding the reflected glory of the Lord. Paul, understanding that glory to be the glory of Christ, makes a connection to the entire Old Testament. The Old Testament shines with the glory of Jesus. If you do not see Jesus in the stories, the poetry, and the didactic sections of the Old Testament, there is a veil over your eyes, your heart, your mind, which keeps you from seeing the real meaning of God's word. That real meaning is always Jesus. What lifts the veil? In short, the gospel. Without the gospel, the Ten Commandments are simply a list of rules on how we are to live our lives, rules that we can't actually keep. With the gospel, we learn that the Ten Commandments also describe the perfect person. That is, they describe Jesus. With the gospel, we learn that the Ten Commandments find their fullest expression in our lives when they drive us to Jesus and to the forgiveness that he offers us. Without the gospel, when we read Old Testament stories like, say, David versus Goliath, we are just reading little bits of history, or at most, perhaps, morality stories about how we should trust the Lord when we face the giants in our life, right? With the gospel, though, we see how God works through unlikely means. We see in the unlikely hero of David a type of Christ who overcomes our foes, indeed our greatest foes, like sin and the devil. These first couple of examples are perhaps a little bit more subjective. The gospel, though, has so enlightened us that there are passages in the Bible that you think are so blatantly obvious that anyone who read them would think that they are about Jesus. But there are many who cannot find Jesus in those passages because the veil has not been lifted from their minds. Take this well-known passage from Isaiah as an example. Isaiah writes, "Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told them, they see. And that which they have not heard, they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him, for he has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring, he shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors." Now, even though you may not understand every line of that particular prophecy out of Isaiah, I seriously doubt that there is anybody here who has any trouble finding Christ in these Old Testament words. Yet, for those who still have the veil over their minds, they just don't see Jesus here. Some think it is about the nation of Israel. Some think that Isaiah was writing about himself. There are other ideas, but the one thing they have in common is that it was not about Jesus. But you, here today, having the veil lifted from your eyes, know that the suffering servant Isaiah wrote about is Jesus. Indeed, if we didn't know better, we would think that it was a quote from the New Testament and not from 7 centuries before Jesus was born. You may thank the Holy Spirit in your prayers for showing you the gospel truth that enlightens the whole Bible, that allows you to easily see that Isaiah was writing about Jesus. Now we can gaze upon the face of God without fear. We do so when we gaze upon our Lord Jesus. We look at him when we study his word, the Bible, not just the New Testament, but the whole Bible. We look at him when we come to the altar of his grace and receive forgiveness. We also look at him when we receive the absolution in our worship service. Instead of trembling and fear because we are in the presence of the glory of God, in the presence of Jesus, we sing for joy. We sing because the veil that obscures our Lord of mercy has been lifted from our minds. It has been done so by the gospel. Now, of course, we see in part, but one day we will stand in his presence and see him face to face. We will behold him with our own eyes and not another's. We will look at him without fear, though his glory will be on full display. That is what the Holy Spirit has done for you through the gospel. You might say that thanks to the Holy Spirit, every time we read the Bible, both Old and New Testament, Jesus is transfigured before our very eyes, and we behold his glory. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.